Guys, I'm starting, I don't care. अच्छा तो सुनो, see when I start talking about any of the sculpture pieces, क्योंकि आज हम sculpture के बारे में बात करेंगे. When I start talking about any of the sculpture pieces, I will tell you what the name is, who the artist is, and वो कब बना है, what was used to make that sculpture specifically. Okay, when I'm explaining all of these things, I would really, really like you guys to either talk about what you are seeing right away, कि मतलब क्या फीलिंग दे रहा है, क्या समझ में आ रहा है. देर आर नो राइट और रॉन्ग आंसर. ओके, इफ यू टेल मी इट लुक्स लाइक आई डोंट नो एन एग, आई एम गुड. बता देना, जस्ट लाइक से इट इधर इन द चैट. इफ यू आर शाय टू अनम्यूट योर सेल्फ एंड से इट आउट लाउड, तो चैट में लिख देना, अदरवाइज एनी वे इज फाइन. ऑल्सो I have the sculptures that I've chosen and the things that I'm going to talk about is I know these things because went to art school or I've done my research. I've read like scholars' papers and what critics have said about all of these things and the museums I've been to and how they've explained the meaning of these sculptures. Side mein likha hua. So not that I am completely like क्या बोलते हैं उसको, लॉस द वर्ड, बट या इट्स नॉट लाइक आई नो फुल अबाउट इट. तो ऑब्वियसली आई मे ऑल्सो बी रॉन्ग, सो प्लीज जो बोलना होगा बोल देना, वॉट एवर यू फील अबाउट एनी ऑफ देम. ओके, लेट्स स्टार्ट गाइस. अमेज बॉल्स, फर्स्ट वन. सो दिस इज द फर्स्ट वन, होल्ड ऑन, कांट सी द चैट्स, देख लो थोड़ा, टेक इट इन, देन. So, this piece is called, and I'm going to pronounce this so wrong, guys. Get ready for it. This piece is called Portrait of Margit Pogni, and it was made by Constantine Brancusi. I am pronouncing these names so wrong. No idea. So yeah, this is the version. This is version one. It was made in 1913, so it's really old. Okay. First, it was made in marble in 1912, and then he remade it in this, which is bronze and bronze with black patina. So, patina is this kind of metal that rusts in a different way, right? मतलब जो हमारा deoxidation जो होता है metal पे, it's a very bluish kind of oxidization. But black patina का yes, that word, guys, happens in a different way. So he used that specifically because the hair, उसको हेयर का टेक्सचर वैसा चाहिए था. So, what do you guys think? What does she look like? What does she make you? What does she remind you of? She reminded me a lot of egg, which is why I said egg in the beginning. Anyone? कुछ तो बोलो यार गाइस, तो मैं बोलू कि नहीं तुम गलत हो.
She looks downcast. She looks like she is either sad or shy or awkward.
Which is true. One of them is true. Who else?
Yeah, definitely look sad. Yeah.
है ना, सैड मुझे भी लगी थी. सो शी मेक्स मी फील लाइक शी इज कोलैप्सिंग इन टू हर सेल्फ. इंटरेस्टिंग. सो कीप कमिंग गाइस, मैं धीरे धीरे और एक्सप्लेन करती रहूंगी इसका एज यू गाइस टेल मी मोर थिंग्स. सो शाय इज राइट, जिसके ऊपर ये पोर्ट्रेट बना है. सो कॉन्स्टेंटीन मेड दिस पोर्ट्रेट ऑफ अ हंगेरियन वुमेन. शी वॉज अ पेंटिंग मेजर. व्हेन शी मेट कॉन्स्टेंटीन इन पेरिस, ही टोल्ड हर टू सिट फॉर हर फॉर वन ऑफ द पोर्ट्रेट्स, राइट? सो यू आर राइट, शी इज अ वेरी शी वॉज, इतने साल तक जिंदा रहेगी तो भूत ही हो जाएगी. शी वॉज अ शाय पर्सन, शी हैड अ वेरी टिमिड पर्सनैलिटी, बट हर फीचर्स वर वेरी स्ट्रॉन्गली आउट देयर. Also a painter, and she was well, as we all know, one of the sad artists. So she, again, that is true that she's collapsing in herself, possibly going through a really tough time at that moment. She looks like she's wearing a shroud. Her face is much bigger than her body. That actually is not her face. If you look closely, it's actually two hands doing this. If you can see me, can you guys see me? It's basically named ki. नींद वाले हाथ है उसके. सो इट्स नॉट हर हेयर, इट्स एक्चुअली हर हैंड्स. व्हाट आई सेड, डज दैट मेक यू थिंक ऑफ समथिंग? शी इज अ वुमेन, हंगेरियन वुमेन, किसी आर्टिस्ट के लिए बैठी थी, काइंड ऑफ इन अ स्लीपिंग पोजिशन. हर आईज आर अ वेरी डिफाइनिंग फीचर. डू यू सी एनी अदर फीचर इन हर फेस दैट इज डिफाइनिंग टू यू गाइस?
above her eyebrow, it looks, I don't know whether it's like a damage as part of like, you know, with like age, but it looks like a scar just above the left eyebrow, right eyebrow.
Right.
Extends to the nose ridge.
Yes. So that's actually not because it is aged or it is a crack or anything else. It's actually her nose. So her nose coming in. So when you are trying to draw a face, a lot of times, a lot of artists, they get really bored. So they draw a face like, they draw a nose like, oh wow, this is such a bad drawing. Hold on, I'll show you. They draw it like this. Can you see that? Can everyone see that? The nose actually just turns into this one line. So that's what he's trying to do here. And there is a reason to that. The reason why he's done that, Tanmay, thanks for pointing that out. Because Constantine was a very simplistic kind of an artist. He believed that tum ek insaan mein cheeze bahut hoti hai that you can show, right? You can show like tons and tons and tons of things. He could have shown the eyebrows. He could have shown like each and every flake. He could have shown the hair. He didn't show. He chose not to show those things because he believed that the more you simplify it, the more you emphasize the features. Now for her, he amplified. Yes.
I have a question for you. So yes. This Constantine that we are talking about, is this guy the ruler of Constantinople? Who's he? Is he a painter with the same name?
Yes, there is. But no, this guy was not. He was just a sculptor, photographer, and painter. So his entire name is Constantine Baron QC. I'm pronouncing that wrong. But nay, he was not a ruler of any sorts. Cool?
Thanks.
Yes. Okay, yeah. So coming back to that. So he believed that the more... So he was one of the modern sculptors. What he did was... yes, someone has their hand up. Please unmute yourself and ask me whatever you want to ask me. I believe your name is 1 plus 3T. Hi, I am 4684. Nay? Okay, I'll continue. Okay, yeah. So he believed that the more you can simplify something, the better you can emphasize on some things. So here he's emphasized on her almond-shaped eyes, her slender nose, her very small face, and a rounded-off chin. So uska chehra kaafi chota tha. And she was a shy kind of a person within herself, keeping a lot of things to herself. She was that kind of a person. So, yeah, in a lot of ways, and in a lot of portrait sculptures, he did believe that you have to simplify it a lot to really emphasize on a lot of things. So he made this, which is version one. Actually, it's version two. But the first one that he made was made in plaster. Then he made a few different versions of her and he kept simplifying it over the years. So in the end, the last one that he made is actually very egg-like hands. You know, just like all you can see is like two eye kind of structures and two hands. And two hands we can simplify line bani hui thi. So you can't really see it very clearly. So he simplified himself even further. Now, moving on to another thing that you can probably notice. So I've mentioned this before, I did notice her to be very egg-like. Now, I thought that was just me. But turns out there are a few people out there in the art world who did believe that he wanted to portray her very egg-like to show the fertility of a woman. Right, because when he met her, she was very young at age, possibly had an affair with her, but art politics are very different, guys. So we're not going to get into art politics. But yeah, so the egg-like structure could also mean her fertility. How many of you think that could be true or possibly can be true? Comment me likh do yaar.
I don't know. Till date, I am not sure that there were egg was considered a symbol of fertility in art is something I'm hearing for the first time. I know of the other symbols. I'm not sure of this one.
No,
I'm not sure. I don't know whether to comment because I'm not very...
No, it is one of them. It is one of them. Because, well, you can... how do I explain this? You can debate that the eggs carried for a child are carried by the man, but then the eggs of fertility are carried by the woman. And in this case, it was because she was very, very young when he met her. And amongst the fact that he did find her very feature-heavy pretty, he also found her soul very pretty, which is what has been said. even her in a few interviews when she talks about how she you know, like interview as in matlab us zamane mein kya interview hote honge, you understand what I'm trying to say, but she did mention that, you know, he was very very respectful and audible about in audible about the fact that he did find her very pretty, very young. So yeah it is a thing. It's not, I'm not like I'm making it up, it's a thing. Then I don't make me conscious. Anyway, so yeah, so he made four of these. Any more questions, guys? Please either unmuting, keep unmuting yourself or putting it up in the chat. Meanwhile, I'm going to move ahead and explaining this further. Yes. So this was, Constantine really changed the way the world looked at sculptures, because a lot of the sculptures in that point of time, which is 1913, they were all about being very realistic. And further than that, they really believed in making everything very romantically realistic. So like having very nicely built shoulders, you know, having the perfect figure and whatnot. So he changed the art world in the sculpture way, in his little way, is by being a little bit of a rebel in what he was making. Like here, as I've mentioned several times, that he was being very, very simplistic with this. So that really pissed a lot of people off. A lot of people did believe that he was a rebel. Later in the years, nowadays, if anyone looks at Constantine, you can see very clearly that there is some amount of cubism happening, because he does have the, and Iska, this is the first, second sculpture that he made of her. The fourth one, if you see, is actually very, very, very oval, two lines. And, you know, like almost a triangle for the eyes. So very cubist kind of ways, and you can kind of see how he could have influenced that wave of painters and artists at that point of time. But that is way before. Cubism was way after him. So yeah, he did influence a lot of people in a lot of ways. Yes, he is early modernist, which basically means that, you know, he's trying to be very, very futuristic in believing that, you know, what is going to happen ahead. I wish men would stop trying to represent women's fertility all the time.
Yeah.
Okay. I just phonetically pronounced ugh. I guess men are obsessed by what they don't have. Guys, you're having a very different chat there. Have fun. Yes. I
feel this very irritated.
Very meditative, yes, it is. Yes, Anji. Meditative also, probably he's trying to show her in a very sleepy way. The hands are also put up like that. He did not sculpt her while she was sitting in front of him. Probably that's also why she's looking meditative, because he sculpted her from memory. He made her sit in front of him, waited for a while. She left for hungry. He used to keep calling her back and making her sit in front of him, because he was memorizing her face. And then when she left, then he made her from memory. So probably to him, she was a very peaceful person. Hence the eyes and the meditative thing that you're getting from it. Yes. Very meditative. Eyes downcast and hands together, any significance? Not specifically in the art world, but yahan pe he is very clearly trying to show her in a very peaceful state, possibly because of the amount of respect he has for her. What else, guys? Hit me with your question. Don't actually hit me.
Could it be that the lady herself trying to be like, I'm trying to show that it is a very respectful to be just a woman. It could be that way also.
Possibly.
Being respectful for her, that somebody else is drawing her. But still, I mean, it's such a, what should I say? In that time, a person drawing a woman. So maybe she's feeling very good about herself.
Yes.
That, you know, that she's at that level that somebody's asking her to sit and, like, you know, taking pains to draw her and put her up on the thing. I mean, I feel that way. I mean,
correct.
I think
That's true, because it was a long time back. It was 1913. At that point of time, it was it was said that a lot of people used to really enjoy themselves seeing in artworks, which is why they used to commission so many. The rich people used to commission a lot of paintings just so that they can be put in those scenarios. So yeah, of course, yes, definitely a completely valid point. Okay. Also very delicate. She is shown very delicately. She is gracefully restrained. What does that make you guys think? Gracefully restrained. That was used by several critics. She was gracefully restrained. I don't believe that she's restrained. I do believe she's very, very peaceful and she's very calm.
No, restrained here, it means like, you know, she's not showing off. That boldness is not there. And restrained in the sense she's very poised. Like with her figure, the way she's standing, I mean, she's just like, you know, restrained in sense, putting all her hand, mother, it's, what should I say, it's all covered around, like, you know, that way, restrained in that way. She's not that flamboyant, like, you know, in any other, a dancing pose, she could have stood. She could have stood in any other way, but then she very, like, you know, put herself together, just like a newborn child, how they're wrapped around in a piece of cloth. You would see that. You know, a child, a newborn child is wrapped around like this so that, like, you know, they can develop properly. Mm-hmm. Something that, like that, I feel.
But I do, I agree with that. I don't agree with the fact that it's not bold. I do believe that it is very bold. And the way he has portrayed her is very bold. Not just with the very simplistic features, but also with the fact that what he's used and the gold color that is just popping out. I do believe that it's very, in a bold way that he's shown her. But yes, in a very being born early ages of
that's what I feel is saying.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, as you guys can all see, it was very opposite of a caricaturist. Caricaturist uses your basic shapes and forms, and he makes it, you know, large and avant-garde. Makes it larger than life, but this guy, he's just taken your features and he's dumbed it down, very simplified. Okay, here's a quote for you all from the artist, Constantine. What is real is not the appearance, but the idea. The essence of things is what's most important. Which I thought was very beautiful. Yeah. A little bit about Constantine before we move on. If you guys have any more questions, please put it up in the chat. Constantine was a Romanian sculptor, painter, and photographer. The reason I have mentioned that he's Romanian is because a lot of his figures and a lot of his paintings and sculptures and photographs did have an influence of old Romanian myths and folk tales. He was very much into representational art, like what a person, what a feeling, what an idea represented more than what it actually looks like. Fun fact, he was in Rodin's workshop. So Rodin is another artist we will talk about right in about 10 minutes. Auguste Rodin was very famous for his very realistic but kind of surreal sculptures. And Constantine went to him and he was in one of his workshops, but he got very bored with the fact that they were all trying to get very modeled hands and modeled faces and hair and eyes and everything right. So he just left really so. He influenced a lot of artists. He was also influenced by Rodin himself. Very modern, very simplistic. Oh, somehow knowing that World War I started in 1914, this sculpture has a very eerie vibe of resolution, calmness and harmony. Huh. Yeah. I forgot that World War started in 1914. Hmm. Anything else, guys, before we move on to the next one? Okay, then. Moving on to the next one. So next one is a fun one. It's a very fun one, guys. It is Franz Kafka's head. So, Franz Kafka was a writer. But this head was made by a guy called David, I'm probably pronouncing it wrong again, but David Carney, I would like to say Forney, but I have no clue. So yeah, David Sony. This is very new. This was made in 2014, not so far back. Before I start, I would like to show you this. Here. So, as you guys saw, this is a crazy sculpture. It moves. It completely moves, and it moves constantly. Yes, it is very disorienting. I saw this in real life, and it was very weird, because for a minute I did not, and it is huge. It is 40 tons of silver plates. What is it? Kinetics, silver plates, nahi. What is it? Forgot. So I can't find it. But yeah, it's 40 tons and it's huge. It's absolutely massive. It's taller than some of the buildings there in Prague. And I did not notice it in the beginning. Why? Because of the mirrored structure that they've mirrored, my God, I'm blanking. Material. That's the mirrored material that he used. It was weird. I did not even notice it being there for a second, because it mirrored so well. I thought it was another building. There was some window that was taking the reflection of one of the buildings nearby. It's made of stainless steel. Thank you. Yes. Thank you, Mama. It was crazy. And then it started moving. Conventional ideas of sculpting or art installation. This is considered an art installation. However, it is also considered a sculpture. So it's like a moving sculpture. But yeah, it is considered an art installation rather than conventional ideas of sculpting. And there's a reason why it's going against the grain of the conventional ideas. Because David Cerny, which again I'm pronouncing wrong, was a rebel. He loved getting people very, very irritated. He used to enjoy pissing people off. So a lot of the, he pissed off the Soviet Union, he pissed off his, national government, he pissed off a lot of people in the UN with a lot of his sculptures. So yes, it is going against the grain, and he used to enjoy that. Every artist ever, yes. I mean, well, I would like to be, but it's sadly not true. But yeah, he really would like to be a rebel. I think if he was not in our age and world right now, he would have really been one of the artists in the Dada movement, because Dada was all about rebelling and going against the grain of everything that the society has taught you ever. So yeah, this moves, and it moves constantly, and it wasn't just trippy, it was also crazy. It was moving very slowly. A lot of times it does not end up making a face, it just goes crazy. It goes in every different direction. The panels move randomly. On their own each. It's not like something that he's put up and then, it moves into a face and then it moves into something else. The panels move on their own individually. Once in a while, it ends up making his face, but his face also moves left and then right. And then he does this with his face. So yeah, very Nagin-like structure. What do you guys think? What are the first impressions, guys? But I move more into it. Anything? Just feel like Miss Briganza every time I say anyone, no one, never mind. Okay, so Kafka was a writer, and he was very upset in his entire life, as writers generally are. He was very, very dark. He died and then got recognition, so he was also very, very depressed. He always self-doubted himself, and he always self-loathed and enjoyed it. So he was never able to get like a full-blown confidence, but his work was very nice. But because of this, in the end of his, years, he got really crazy. So that really affected his work and his writings a lot. And David Cerny was trying to do that with this sculpture. He was trying to show how Kafka constantly was confused in himself. You know, like the face is changing, right? So look here, look there. It'll probably not be a face. So trying to really, you know, hone into that, the idea of what Kafka went through in his mind when he used to write in the later stages. It's like making faces at all who watch. Yeah, yeah. It's kind of like it's making fun of you. You can also see yourself in it. So yeah. I love the dynamism of this art installation, very 3D and captivating, love. Hence movement. Yes, this movement is, I completely agree with you, because I stood there for a good 15 minutes with one of my friends and he forgot to take a picture. We were just staring at it. I'm sure you can watch this for hours. Yes, I really can watch this for hours. I absolutely can. Even on YouTube, I could watch this for hours. It's great. Another fun fact, this was made right next door to this insurance company where Kafka actually did work before he started writing. So kind of like this, you know, when I got to know about this, you know, Kafka head and what he did and everything, it just sounded like the artist was really attacking Kafka and his method. But yeah, how can you forget to take a picture then? I did forget. I had to come back because I saw this. And then I was like, this is amazing. And then I left. And I had to come back. Who takes care of this installation? The government does. So once in a while, the public cleaners will come. They'll clean it up. Leave. So many moving parts. Yes. But it's not India. There is not a lot of dust. Mom, who's asking the right questions? Yeah. Yeah, like I mentioned, the movement is really adding on to how Kafka used to always self-doubt and self-loathe. But the mirroring also adds on to it by showing how the mirrored stuff, like he's not only self-doubting, but a lot of things that are happening around. Someone's writing amazing on this picture. Got you. But yeah, so... not just the self-doubt and self-loathing with the moving, but the mirroring also added on to this by saying that he used to get influenced a lot with a lot of things that were happening around him. So as I have mentioned before, and the one before that, a lot of artists did get very influenced with where they were, how they were growing up, and the things that happened in their surroundings, and what time they were growing up in. All of that really, really affected an artist's work a lot. And it was the same for Kafka. Probably a little bit more because he was very easily, he could easily be, again, have forgotten the word, but yeah, you could easily change his mind. Yeah. The patterns are random. I think I mentioned that. Mirror to take in the surrounding too. Yes. Also, David Sony was a very different, he is not dead. He's a very different kind of an artist. As much as he likes to rebel and, you know, take a stand and get, you know, piss a lot of people off, he does make a lot of, sense with what he's doing. And he also always tries to explain a lot of...
Very different things.
Was he commissioned to do this or he just had some affinity towards Kafka? No, he was not commissioned to do this. Till what I've read, I may be wrong. Do not quote me on this. He did think Kafka was a very interesting person to look into and look into his life too, because he was a very, very dark person. So I think he got his inspiration from there.
This is absolutely amazing. Spending so much of time just to make out something totally different.
Yeah.
Sculpture of a different level whatsoever. Yeah. Like, you know, even if you think out of the box, I mean, I feel that way.
Uh-huh.
Sculpting is generally with wood, stone, you know, things like this, but something like this, which is rotating and changing. I mean, a person has to really have that kind of level to even think something so different from what is going on from his times. I mean, way beyond, like, you know, what was going on there. And obviously people did not understand, I guess. So that is why we got into depression.
Oh, you're talking about Kafka. Yes. Yes. Yes, he was way ahead of his time. A lot of the scholars today really believe that Kafka was trying to say a lot of really, really strong things. But they are now thinking about it. And they're now reading his stuff. And what do you mean by dark? Why will I say dark as in color? No, dark as in him, not his temperament. But his ideas were very dark. What he was trying to talk about was very dark. Would we call him a fickle mind who was always observing and soaking in what was going around him and taking inspiration from it and then articulating as a mode of expression? And yes, good usage of material, truly out of the box. Yes, very well put, Mama. Thank you. Very, very well put. He was a very fickle-minded person, Kafka. And David Cerny has really beautifully captured it in this. It's very very beautifully articulated. Thank you. And she's trying to show Kafka's tortured personality, just looking at the notes that I don't forget all the things that I wanted to say. Yes, David is a controversial, like I mentioned, he's a very controversial artist. He's modern and provocative and he likes it. What else? That's it. So the two pieces that I've spoken about right now, I have gone by them very quickly. That's because the third one that I want to speak is going to be a little longer one, and I've kept a lot of time for that one. It's by August. I'm just going to pronounce all of them wrong, guys. I'm sorry for it. August Rodin. That I pronounced properly because French. Haha. Hold on, I'm going to read the
book. You're going to cover The Thinker by Auguste Rodin.
Yes, so the thing was, I wanted to cover The Thinker, but it was too obvious. So I'm going to talk a little bit about The Thinker.
Okay. I always said Augustus Rodin because I mean Desi, but like
It's R-O-D-I-N, so I don't blame you.
Rodin.
Yeah,
exactly.
What do you mean by torched personality? Of Kafka? Well, just the way he was raised and brought up and everything around him, he went through a lot of tragedies in life and everything around him just added on to it. Which is what I mean by torched personality. Or do you mean David Cerny? David Cerny just wants to piss people off. It's just amazing. I love it. Is the mirroring also to tell the viewer that is exactly what happens inside everyone's head too? Yes. Yes. I mean complexities within each one viewing it as a mirror too. Yes. Yes. It is not only to take the surroundings in to kind of also show you the mirror. What you are feeling that day. How you are that day. Probably if I go back there right now, I'm not going to have the same feelings I had when I went there first. Similarly as Kafka did, but Kafka went through these emotions very quickly, making it worse for himself. Yes, guys, you're just killing it today. You're all understanding exactly what is happening. August Rodin, guys, do it. Okay, so first I will show you. Okay, I'm just going to show you the piece. So this beautiful piece is called The Three Shades. The three shades. Hold on, just I need. Yeah, it's called The Three Shades, right? This is huge bronze sculpture by Auguste Rodin, made in 1886. He made it a few different ways. First, made it in plaster. It was supposed to be small. Then he made it bigger, then he made it bigger, and then he made it bigger. Now, why did he make this? For which I need to show another image, and I will come back to this, guys. I know it sounds like I'm rushing. Stop me if I am rushing too much. But I will come back to this image, just have to show you where it started from. So this is a sculpture by Auguste Rodin. It was supposed to be the gate to an actual museum that was supposed to be in Paris. This is called the Gates of Hell. So as you can see on the very top, it's the three shades, which is the sculpture piece we're going to talk about right now. If you look at it lower on the how do I explain this? Okay, right below the middle guy in the three heads, right below him, the thinker is right there. So originally the thinker was supposed to sit right on top of gates of hell, because trying to show that the thinker is looking down at hell and thinking about everything life has to offer. However, he was then pushed down, and then the three heads had come up. Yes, Divine Comedy vibe. Yes, that's exactly where it's from. It's Dante's Divine Comedy, and Rodin has picked up all of these sculptures to make the gates of hell from the idea of Divine Comedy, which is by Dante. So yeah, coming back to our three shades, they were and finally end up being on top because he wanted to showcase that the three guys who are actually, it's the same person just in three different poses. They're all looking down into the fickle, not fickle, they're looking down into the fiery gates of hell. In this hell, there is no God. It is just the gates of hell. The gates of hell actually has 108 pieces of sculptures in it. And the thinker, the three shades, and all of these, a lot of the kiss also is in it somewhere, tiny somewhere. But a lot of Rodin's pieces have accumulated into the gates of hell. Now, coming back to our three shades of hades. There you go. Now, what are the first thoughts when you guys see this? I know Pankhuri said that dude's neck is just never ending. Yes. What else, guys? What else do you guys see? It's, and when I first saw it, I thought it was creepy. I thought they all broke their necks. Honestly speaking, I really thought they all broke their necks. What do you guys see?
I don't know, but that looks like a Bollywood dance move to me, like the beginning of a Bollywood dance move. Joke aside, I don't know, it looks like they're all collectively trying to get at something. Not collectively is the wrong word. I think they're all trying to trying to snatch, or they're trying to grab, or I don't know. It looks like there is a certain urgency to where they want. Yeah, they're all trying to like pull at something. Either they're doing it collectively and as a unified front, or they're all trying to pull it in three different directions, because all three of them want it. Right? It's either a sack of grain, or that's of course left to the imagination. But
you're not wrong. But kind of focus a little bit more on what their hands are actually doing. They're pointing. Right.
Oh, okay. Their muscles.
Pointing.
The first thing which attracts is the muscles. The kind of muscles. The look which gives is the muscles, the way they have been made, all the muscles around the full body.
Yes.
I mean, the legs, the hands, I mean, there is so much of perfection in it. It seems like actually they're real, like, you know, that's what gives the first look.
So,
first of all, like, you know, the sculpture in itself, the muscles which is there in the person, a human figure, that has been done beautifully. Mm-hmm. Yes, they are pulling at something collectively, yes.
No, Aunty, you're completely right. They are very modeled figures. That's a lot of people believe that. I don't know if it's completely true, but a lot of scholars did believe, and a lot of critics still to this day believe, that he makes these very muscled figures, not just because he used to like a perfect modeled body, but he also used to, in the beginning when he was sculpting people, he sculpted from life, and the people he got were laborers who had really sculpted bodies and muscles.
Yes.
Why influenced it in his work too? And yes, their hands are collectively going somewhere, but they're actually pointing. So the reason why it's put up at the end, it went up on the gates of hell, is because they're trying to point towards the gates of hell. So they were actually pointing at an inscription that goes on the gates of hell, which was, "Abandon woe, all ye who enter." So that's what they're actually pointing at.
Repeat it once again. Yeah.
Abandon all hope, all ye who enter here. So all of the people who enter hell, abandon all hope. Basically, that's what he's trying to say. Okay, I have missed some comments. Okay, where did you go? Wait, guys, hold on. Very easy. Joined by thought. Yes, they are joined by thought because it's the same person in three different ways. Joined by the thought of probably standing on top of gates of hell. Probably talking about, again, this quote which was supposed to be on gates of hell. So yes. Weird Z and MD vibe. That's weird. That's just... why do all heads lean to the left? Well, that's just a... Okay, so when you're trying to, so I'm going to try to talk about this as a very sculpt, from a very sculptural point of view. When you're trying to sculpt something, if one head is going towards the right, one is going to the left, it's going to take more space. Plus, if they're all leaning towards this, and Rodha used to want to get a lot of perfection in his pieces, if all of them are leaning towards the left, you can see all of their faces. You know, you won't have to bend to see someone else's face. Plus, he'll be able to use this weird, how do I explain that? He used to use very weird shape. Like, this is not a position you can get into. Physically try to get into this shape, in this position, guys. The neck, it's not possible to get it that horizontal. So he used to use these kind of tricks to enhance what he was making. Hence, hopefully that answers your question on why all the heads lean to the left. There is a very stupid theory by one critic that whenever he used to sculpt all of these things, he used to sculpt them facing north, which is just silly because wherever he moves, north would change, and this, wherever this is kept, north would change.
It could represent the left side of brain. It could represent the left side of brain working more than the right side of brain. It could be that way also. Because thoughts and emotions are on two different levels, so it could be that way also.
That's very much possible. Yes.
Representing that.
Yes. Very much possible. Very much possible. Open to interpretation, guys. Completely open to interpretation. Give me a second while I try to find. Never mind. Huh. Next. They have one hand forward. Yes. Pointing towards the gate of hell. Left hands again. Yes. Yes. Does all of them, you know, probably, guys, I'm really sorry, probably I have missed something about the leaning left and left-handed. Probably I have missed out on it from all the research that I did, even today, and the classes I've been to, nothing was mentioned for the left. Maybe wrong, maybe missing something here, guys, sorry.
There's all used to have satanic implications. Yeah, left hand used to have satanic implications at some point. I remember people who were left-handed were... I don't know, there was a satanic curve or implication to left-handedness and the left hand in the Middle Ages. From what I've read, I can't recall, but there is definitely literature on this.
Well, it would make sense because you would use left hand for everything, and the left hand would be the hand against the grain, probably adding on to all of it. I think that makes sense. Okay. Does all of them being naked have any significance? Well, you can debate that because they are kind of getting into the gates of hell. You have to be in your true form. You can't have material possessions from the earthly world. In this scenario, that could possibly be the reason why they are naked. Otherwise, they actually, all of the artists in the olden days used to sculpt people without clothes, because it's easier to sculpt the bodies than it's to sculpt clothes. That's what all my professors have taught me, and I have understood also. It's just really hard to sculpt clothes, guys. They're trying to get hold of something, and all the three heads are joined together. So it may also say that they are in collective concentration in trying to get hold of something. Why three in number? Well, three in number because Satan, six, three, there. Also, it's an odd number. They are trying to reach, okay, so they are pointing at the gates of hell. They're trying to reach toward the gates of hell. I don't think they're holding anything. I do believe that they might be trying to open the gates of hell. Open to interpretation. Completely. Collective concentration pe yahan jab baat aati hai, basically what happens is that he's used the same one guy. So actually it may be very evident to some of you guys who know Michelangelo's work. So this is very influenced by the David that Michelangelo made, David that Michelangelo made. It's David's figure made three times and in different positions. So the reason why you feel like there's a collective concentration because it's the same person and obviously the heads coming together. But what he's actually trying to say is that no matter how close, how together some people may look, right? It is always going to be to each their own. Like it's always going to be you in the end. You are going to be the only person who goes in. You may have different mindsets. You may have people close to you. You may have similar thoughts with a lot of people. But in the end, it's just you. Because even if they're collected by their, joined by their head, they're very, very apart with their legs. And the legs, actually, if you guys have noticed, they're very heavy set legs. And he this is very, very Rodin-like. His hands and legs used to be very, very strong and heavy. And the reason why a lot of his figures are leaning downwards, even if you think about the thinker, he's looking down, his legs are also down. One of his hand is also down. Is because the weight of life was a very big thing for him. The weight of life, how everything that you do is going to pull you down into the earth, because that's where you've come from, that's where you end up being. And also, well, he's an artist, and depression is real, guys.
Mithila. I just looked up the Wikipedia page for The Gates of Hell. The very first line is, it was inspired by Dante's Inferno from his Divine Comedy, the three parts of his poetry.
Yes, I'm coming to that.
Okay. Because I was, it was driving me mad. So I just.
Sorry. I'm so sorry. I'm coming to that. You need to.
I'm so sorry for that.
It's okay. Like the enthusiasm, Tanmay, please keep it going. Okay. Wait. Where? Okay, therefore they seem to be more so and dejected. Sounds like I can see why J.K. Rowling got her Gringotts inspiration, yeah. Standing on top of the gates of hell, proportions do not seem right. Upper body is heavier, hands are too long. No, upper body seems heavier, but it's actually his legs. His legs are huge. If you see it in real life, his legs are very way out of proportion. But that's just how Rodin used to use very weird body forms and shapes to elevate the structure a lot. Even if you look at the thinker, the thinker has his right leg over his left leg and then he has his left hand over his right knee. It's very hard to sit in that position. I've tried to do that. He specifically used to do that to enhance all of these things. Proportions are going to be weird for Rodin. The gates of hell look like every single Divine Comedy Inferno. Yes, yes, Tanmay. Left hand used to have satanic implication. Yeah. One father, two son, three Holy Spirit. Yes. Very possibly true. Yes. Yes, that makes a lot of sense actually. That actually makes a lot of sense. So someone has written, guys, that there are three people, the number three of them, because one the father, two the son, three the Holy Spirit. However, in reading this,
it could be the good side, the bad side, and the spirit side, the soul side.
Probably.
The good, bad, and the, it could be that way also.
It could be that way too. Because I have read a lot of literature in this piece specifically. The gates of hell don't have a god, does not follow Christian thinking. So, could be possible, could be not. Open to interpretation, like every art piece is, guys. Three as a number has a very significant feature in mythology, Christianity, and other religions also. It is a number pointing towards Satan's, yes. Maybe one of the interpretation. Yes. I got excited because I didn't expect to be validated. Same, Tanmay, same. Completely same. Okay. So, coming to Dante's Divine Comedy. For those who don't know a lot about it, I'm going to jump into it very little bit. So, in the Dante's Divine Comedy, the shades, which are these three men, are the souls of the damned or the souls of the departed countrymen who danced in a circle as they told their story. Okay. So they stood in front of the gate of hell, which is why he ended up removing the thinker from standing on top and then put him up. Yes.
Can you please repeat? You cracked up a lot.
Sorry. Okay. So in Dante's Divine Comedy, the shades, which is the name of this piece too, the three shades, are the souls of the damned who stand in front of the gates of hell, or the soul of the departed countrymen who dance, who danced in circles as they told their story, right? So hence, the thinker was first put atop, the gates of hell, but then he changed it to the shades because that was what he was following with Dante's Divine Comedy. The downward thrust of the arms and their heads conveys despair as they summon the viewer to gaze upon the drama of sin. Again, from Dante's Divine Comedy. So, the gates of hell has a lot of not just inspiration, but direct motivating factors from Dante's Divine Comedy. Actually, Tanmay, would you like to share some information on it with us? Would you like to share something with us on Dante's Divine Comedy?
Okay, so this was a poem written by Dante. It is an epic poem.
Yeah.
It basically talks about the journey of one person who goes through it's in three parts. Part one is Inferno, which is basically hellfire. Part two is purgatory.
Yeah.
And part three is paradise. So there are several. It's supposed to be one of the greatest works of art, the greatest works of literature in the West, in the greatest works of Western literature. Now, incidentally, somebody pointed out number three is prominent. It's also number three is prominent in mythology. It does allude to the Trinity. Even here, the three parts, the fact. So basically, it's. These three places, basically hell, purgatory, and paradise, are considered the three realms of the dead.
Mm-hmm.
And it is written, it basically depicts his journey, which starts from Good Friday and ends at Easter. This is basically like it's supposed to be three different parts of again, these are very symbolic. I think, and one thing I've read the poem years ago, but I read Dan Brown book on the first of on Inferno, and okay, that is, well, you can laugh at me for Dan Brown, but the point is, they've depicted the seven deadly sins in various ways throughout the poem.
Okay.
I think purgatory does, especially purgatory. Purgatory is the one where purgatory is basically where you're being cleansed, what's the word for it? Purgatory is where you're being. It's redemption.
Okay.
Inferno is where you suffer. Purgatory is redemption, and paradise is where you finally achieve. I'm rambling, but this is what I have interpreted over the years.
Uh-huh.
I should read this again. I will. Yeah.
I have inspired people. Amazing. Thank you.
You're better at the articulation.
Wow.
You should do it.
Wow! Beautiful. Thank you so much. It was very informative.
Thanks, guys. Thank you, Auntie. Thank you, Tanmay. Thank you, all of you, for giving me so much validation. But yeah, thank you so much, Tanmay, for giving me a little more about Dante's Divine Comedy. Moving on. Yes. Purgatory would be physical death to purification post which paradise. Yes.
Thank you, guys. You're helping me.
But then that makes it Christianity. See, that's what I'm saying. A lot of the things that I've read about the three shades of Rodha, it doesn't have a God and it doesn't follow Christianity, which is why it is so confusing to me, because I also believed it was, like the Father, the God, the Son. I did think it was that, but then it's not Christianity. Then why? Why? Yeah. Okay. A few more things. Okay, I spoke about all of these things. Hold on. Okay. So one of the critics believed that they personified death, the three ways you could die. He was very, very, very popular with this theory, but didn't really pan through, because I tried to follow the thread, but generally go through. What do you guys think about it? Could it personify the dead, three ways of being dead, or just the dead? Because I do believe that they could personify death in general. I don't know how they personify the dead. They don't seem dead. I mean, yeah, the positions are very weird. Probably very nearly headless Nick from Harry Potter. But I don't see them personifying dead. Nothing. Exactly. What are the three ways of being dead? I searched and searched and it makes no sense. I did not come up with anything. Can you repeat? I didn't get him. Okay. So one of the critics believed that Rodan was trying to personify the dead. Okay. Now, or the three ways of being dead. Now, this was one of the most popular comments on this. But, you know, in Google, like, I tried to find more. But it didn't lead anywhere. What are the three ways of being dead? Like, do you guys know what that is? Like, I have no clue what are three ways of being dead. I do believe that it could personify death. Because it's kind of like showing you the gates of hell. But I don't know, how does it personify dead people? Like, they're not dead. You know, they are very weirdly put, but they're not dead. Not dead. Also, a lot of people did believe that the reason why the heads are the way and they're, you know, like joined at one place, because he made the same figure and just rotated it three times. But I have also seen this in real life, and there are a few things that are different in like the muscles in the hands. So he definitely did not cast it to, you know, cast one and then made three of it. He did make all the three separately, but they do have very similar shapes. Again, I don't know how they personify dead. Mind, body, soul, dead. Yes. See, now that makes sense. You could be dead in your mind, dead by body, or dead by soul. See, now that makes sense. That would be the three, and the three from, you know, the myths and other folks. Yeah, that helps. Also, guys, did you not? Are the modern millennials are soul dead? Guys, chill. Guys, did you not notice the legs? The legs are very bothering to me. Like, some of the legs, you almost can't see the left leg. And they're also, they're kind of doing the single ladies dance. It's a very weird, their legs are really weird, guys. They're very big. Compared to everything else, they're very big. And into the earth. I mean, ground, not earth, ground. Yeah. Okay, a little bit about Rodha probably gives you a little more idea on what they are trying to say. Dude, it did. Sun literally just said it reminds him of single. It does remind me of the single ladies. He's like, sorry, Rodha, not making fun of your statue. Okay, so Rodha, Michelangelo was his favorite, hence the David. He was a French sculptor and he used to draw very well. He was known for a lot of his architectural drawings. He was very precise in his drawings. So he was nearsighted. So when he went to school and people were trying to teach him stuff, he couldn't really see the board. So he used to understand how he was getting better by drawing himself. His wife's name was Rose and his girlfriend's name was Camille. Now, this is important because this is one of the hot goss of art world till today, that a lot of people believe that he in the end days, right before he died, in his end days, he left his wife Rose for Camille, and then, because Camille was another artist, that he left his wife Rose for Camille, and then they had a child together and everything. But the French don't believe this. They do believe, or probably they're in denial, that it was a very beautiful, loving relationship between Rodha and Rose, and they're just not ready to believe it. Can I see the Eiffel Tower poking behind one guy? Please, go ahead. So between being dead and getting resurrected, where was Jesus? He might be floating through hell, purgatory, and heaven. Again, three. So is the sculptor trying to suggest that? I'm stumped. Wow. Okay. Just a thought. That is a 3 days between being dead and... See, the three does come up a lot in a lot of myths and in Christianity and a lot of religious texts too. Where Jesus was? before he was getting resurrected. I think he was in purgatory, because if you've gone to heaven or hell, you've gone. You just passed through, right? But in purgatory, which I also believe, I mean, yeah, this is going to sound really silly, but it's a great piece of, great piece of literature, and do really like it a lot. Where Harry Potter was when he died, he also, I believe, he went to purgatory. He went and he came back. Because if you go further than that, like Dumbledore told him to, he would have never come back, right? So I think it is, I think it's in the middle. What do you guys think? But I think it's in the middle, Mama. Skaldo might be trying to suggest that. He might be. He was a symbol of God on earth. So obviously he passed through all of this and came back. See, that's what I'm saying. I don't think he passed through all of them. I think he went and he came back. He went midway and he came back. So if he would have gone all the way, then God would have kept him. Does that make sense? Makes sense to me. But yeah, it's a very interesting part. Wow, I'm going to think about that. See. Oh, wow, I started thinking right now. Wait. You know, also, if it was Jesus... if Rodan was trying to symbolize God on earth or trying to take this track of Jesus going and coming back, that means he's following the Christian thought of hell, which he's not here. They're specifically told he's not. It takes me back to a lot of episodes of Supernatural. We've gone to Jesus, we've gone to Rona, we've gone to Harry Potter, we've gone everywhere, we've gone places, guys. See, that's why I said this piece is going to take a while. Okay, moving on. So Rona in his lifetime made a lot of work. He made a lot of work. Tons and tons and tons and tons and tons. Bahut kaam hai bande ka paas. Probably vela tha. Then why does he call it Gates of Hell? Well, he calls it Gates of Hell because of Dante's Divine Comedy. He's taken it from that. Gates of Hell is literally Gates of Hell. Usme jitne log hain that are depicted in that has been taken from Divine Comedy. One slight problem, change. I said there are 108 figures in the Gates of Hell. There are actually 180. My dyslexia kicked in. It's 180, not 108. So he was rejected from a lot of colleges. One of the colleges that I was trying to get into. So I'm not any worse than Rodan, guys. he was also kicked out from the Salon. Salon was one of the first things that started in Paris where artists were selected to showcase their work. And he was kicked out because the piece that he put up to showcase there was made. He was a portrait of it was a head of a laborer, and they didn't think that it was beautiful enough to be counted as art. And Rodin was trying to just be very, very realistic. So it was like a broken nose, and his face was a little like torn, slouching and all that. So he was also rejected from the Salon. Yeah, that's it, guys. And I finished in time again. Yes. So guys, a lot of things that I've mentioned, like I said really early in the beginning, a lot of you guys were not there yet. This is all the knowledge that I have gathered from a lot of research that I do on the pieces that I like, the classes that I've sat in, the European history I've taken from all the artists, my professors who are artists, the art historians that I've met, and the people who take you on tours of the gallery. In some of the places, I might be wrong. Don't get upset or kill me. But yeah, it's not 100% right. But till where I know and I believe, they are right. You can quote me on a lot of those things. Also, these sessions are very, open. If anyone likes to say, like, I really enjoyed Tanmay. Thank you very much again for chiming in. I really enjoyed that. So it's like a lot of people, I would really like a lot of you guys to say a lot more. I did one on painting and everyone really enjoyed that. So I'm going to start a series of paintings where I'm taking a specific era or a specific artist and talk three of those paintings in the sessions. The next one, however, is going to be on film and film, like really crazy films, guys. You're working on some really crazy ones. Oh, one question or two. Why is it called the three shades though? Oh, the three shades, because that's what Dante called them. The three shades who are, wait, I have the explanation. Wait, I have it. Okay, yeah, in Dante's Divine Comedy, they're also called three shades, three souls that are standing in the gates, on the front of gates of hell. So yeah, that's why they're called three shades. So Om Dar Badar, of course. Yes, so yes, I'm going to come back to painting, guys. The next one is going to be on film, some crazy one that we've picked up. It's going to be a lot of fun. I'm going to have a fellow colleague and friend joining me and explaining those movies. So yeah, it'll be fun. And after that, I'll start with the painting and art installations, actually, to begin with. So yeah, it's going to be fun, guys.
Thanks, it is too good.
Thank you.
Very informative, very nice. God bless. Beautiful it was. Beautiful session.
Thank you. Stop. I need to
awesome.
Stop. But yeah. Thanks, guys, for coming and listening to me rant today. I'm just going to sit here while you guys, like I always do, sit here while the participants list go from 12 to 11 to 10 to 9 to 8. Yes. Bye, guys. Thank you, Mama, for coming. You gave me a lot to think about.